North Reading Reads program is pleased to present Roland Marullo for the North Reading Reads program.
We are also grateful to Steve DeFranza for his help with our Finally, I would like to thank all of you for your participation in North Reading Reads 2006. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Next, we have Bob Ward, the chairperson of the English Department at the high school and member of the North Reading Reads Committee, who will introduce our speaker.
Good evening. My name is Bob Ward. As Vicki said, I'm a teacher here at North Reading High School, and I've been a member of North Reading Reads since the first project. And one of the chief pleasures of being a member of this group is the actual selection of the book. It's always a challenge to come up with the right book for the next project, but the discussions are always interesting. And it's not often that readers have the chance to get together and just talk about books out of pleasure. And it's always interesting to hear what the members of this group have been reading lately and what has made an impact on them and what they're thinking about and what they think would be good for this project. And in the latest selection process, there was one book that whose title kept coming up again and again, and you could probably guess which title that is. I had not read In Revere in those days at that point, but a couple of members, maybe more than a couple of members, had read it and kept bringing it up again and again. It was a book that really hit them, and their affection for the book was obvious. And when we found out that there was a chance to have the author here as well, the book already had a strong appeal, but that did get even stronger. As we know, In Revere in those days is the story of Anthony Benedetto as an individual, but it's also the portrait of a city. And I think we would all agree that we have a much stronger and more appreciable idea of the city of Revere from this book. For some of us, Revere was a first-hand experience, because I know we have some Revere people here tonight. For others of us, we got an introduction to the city maybe from a friend or a colleague, and that introduction may have taken certain forms, which I probably shouldn't discuss, but at any rate, I am obviously in this middle category, because I got to know Revere through a friend, and I really was impressed with the city and the effect it had on her. And for others of us, the book may have been the first introduction to the city. But whichever category you fall into, I think we all agree that this novel presents a cast of characters that makes an immediate impact and a setting that inspires all of us to think more appreciatively of our own hometowns and what we've gotten from those hometowns. It takes a special author to enable us to garner so much from a novel, and I am honored to introduce such an author tonight. May I present Mr. Roland Arullo.
Short story writers. And then I might read like a couple of free surprising to me where the books come from. I reread part of this book, half of it, in preparation for speaking here tonight, because I've written, hundreds of thousands of words since I wrote this book, and it's been 5 or 6 years, and I wanted to have some pretty good memory of it in case someone said, "You remember that character?" I read it, it's like somebody else wrote it to me. I don't know where it comes from. I don't think about it too much. I don't plan it. I just sit down. I work hard. At least I used to work hard, trying to learn the skills and stuff like that. And I read a lot, wrote a lot, and had a lot of frustrations. But so I don't want to make it sound like it's, I open the spigot and it just pours out of me. In some way, it feels like that. So I was writing another book. And I was about halfway through it. This was 2000, I think. And I was unhappy with it. I was uneasy with it. It just didn't feel like anything special to me. And that's a tricky business, because one of the demons of writing, and I use that word guardedly, I don't think it's a particularly difficult profession. Certainly not as difficult as some things I've done, but one of the things that does make it difficult is that you don't really know where you stand a lot of time. You don't know if something's good, you don't know if it's good enough, you don't know if it's a complete piece of junk. And so you're constantly having to wrestle with that in your own mind, because you're putting in a year or 2 years, or in the case of my first book, 6.5 years, and you don't know that you'll ever get anything out of it. You don't know if you'll ever get paid. You don't know if anybody else will ever read it. So you're constantly having to do this little game where you measure your mood. You're saying, do I hate this just because I'm in a bad mood, a particularly self-critical mood? Do I love this just because I just wrote it and my own brain is judging it, my own brain produces, so my own brain thinks it's great? But I was about halfway through a book, and I don't even remember what the book was, and I was dissatisfied with it over a fairly long period of time. And that, usually I won't keep going when that happens, but I had put in 100 or 200 pages, and I thought, I should just keep going. And we had, I have two young girls, 8 and 4. We were married a long time before we had children. It's not a second wife. At that time, we had one girl, Alexandra, and my wife took her and went to visit her mother, who lived in Connecticut, and they stayed overnight. And especially with young children, you really miss them. And I was sitting upstairs in my office, a writing room, and they were in Connecticut, and it was 9 o'clock at night, 10 o'clock at night, which is when I like to write anyway. And I could feel viscerally the love that I had for my daughter, which I'm sure everybody here can relate to. And it was connected in my mind or my heart to a love that I had received when I was a child. My family wasn't perfect, we had some problems, but warmth was not one of them. I was surrounded by warmth and by people constantly touching me and telling me they loved me, that I was okay, that I was special, at least to them. And that was true for all my cousins. My father was from a family of 8 kids. My mother was from a family of 7 kids. Good Catholics, they had a lot of kids themselves. And so I had a lot of cousins, most of whom lived within walking distance of me. And on Sundays, I lived, when I was really young, on top of my father's parents and then next door to them. And all my cousins would come to visit on Sundays. All of them and my father's family. And so the backyard was like a circus. I'm not sure how nice it was for the adults, but for the kids it was great. We would just, we had all these friends. say it, but there were almost no bad feelings or arguments. I never remember one of my aunts or uncles or cousins saying anything to me that would make me feel bad about myself. I did that on my own. it was an unusually supportive group, and I didn't appreciate it, you know, as you would have been. And as I get older and I see what life is like, I appreciate that more and more. So I was thinking about Alexandra, I was feeling that love for her, and I started to feel this, started to remember inside myself that love that I had received as a child. And my Aunt Violet, who's now deceased, had an 80th birthday party celebration at a restaurant, Route 1, and a lot of those cousins and the living aunts and uncles, surviving aunts and uncles, had come. And it was tremendously moving to me. I had my little girl there, and it was really just a great, great night. And I actually left to take Amanda and Alexandra back to the hotel because Alexandra had to get to sleep, and then went back to the party. But before I went back, I had in the car a copy of Revere Beach Boulevard, and I opened it up and I wrote in the back on the blank page, someday I want to write the story of this kind of love. And I wrote maybe a paragraph, you know, elaborating on that. And then I never tried to do that until this night that I've been talking about. I set the other book aside. I almost always write longhand with a fountain pen and a yellow legal pad. All my books have been written that way. But I said, I'm at the computer, let me just write down something about this feeling and see what happens. So I won't read much of it, but I wrote this first section. My name is Anthony Benedetto. I live what might be called the secret life. And then I wrote 30 pages that night. Just typed it out almost as fast as I could type it. It was pretty fast. Had 30 pages, printed it out, went to bed. Woke up the next day and read it. I thought, oh, this looks good. This looks pretty good. This looks better than the book that I'm writing. Which is not one of those demons, because it's like having a girlfriend or a boyfriend or a husband or a wife. You know? I mean, sometimes when you first meet somebody, they seem absolutely perfect. There's nothing wrong with them. You know? And then time goes by and you start to see what's wrong with them, and then you start to see everything that's wrong with them. And then maybe, you know, you come out of that and you say, okay, yeah, there's a few things wrong with her, there's a few things wrong with me, but, you know, we're all right. We're going to stay together, whatever. And it's that way with a book. You have an image in your mind of a story that you want to tell. It seems perfect because it's not there. It's just imaginary. And as soon as you start to write it down, it becomes imperfect. And so the longer you go, if you've written 100 pages, there's a lot of imperfections in there. And you can say, oh yeah, that book is all right, but this book in my mind is way better. And you can just jump from half book to quarter book to 10% book your whole life and never write a book. So that's another one of those little demons to watch out for. The next day I woke up, I read it, it seemed good. By the next night, it seemed like the worst piece of that I ever written in my life. I don't know why that happens. It's absolutely awful. I said, it's ridiculous. I'm going to go back to the old book. I put the 30 pages on the table in my bed, and about a week or 10 days later, I read them again. I thought, that's not that bad. Then I just committed myself to it. I said, I'm going to write the book. And I wrote it in 6 weeks, which is a new technique of my styling for the Vintage Boulevard. I just get it out absolutely as fast as I can get it out. Good, bad, and ugly. I just let it come out. And that way, you don't get stuck someplace. I don't even reread it most of the time. You don't have the self-doubt that says, you know, maybe I should put this book aside. 6 weeks, I just splashed it all out and then spent a year or two fixing it. And then we had a terrible winter. I think it was, I don't know what year it was. 2001. Very snowy, cold winter, at least where I live, which is in western Massachusetts. And my daughter, Alexander, was diagnosed with cystic fibrosis, which is a terrible disease. And the graph of the writer's income goes like this. You know, I get a phone call that's worth, let's say, $50,000, and then I won't get a paycheck for 11 months, not, you know, a few hundred dollars or something. So we were this part of the graph, you know. And she was diagnosed, and it was a terrible winter, and it was a rough time. So I started calling up golf resorts and asking if they would host me, which my wife thought was a particularly crazy thing to do. I said, I called up these golf resorts down south, and I said, I'm a golfer, I've written some golf stuff, I'm thinking of writing a golf book. How'd you like to have my family and me come down here for a couple weeks and not pay anything? Very nice. I really love working for myself. I like not having a boss and not having co-workers, not having a place to go, being able to work at any hour. But sometimes when things are going bad, you wish you had a place to go. You wish you had a co-worker or something like that. You wish you could come home and complain about that person. But we went down to these golf resorts in South Georgia and South Carolina. And my agent at the time was trying to sell this book during those days. And she kept calling me up and saying, agents are funny. She wouldn't use the word rejection. I prefer the straightforward, they hated it. But she would say, you know, Viking pass. And but we had it. I had it out at St. Martin's and Farrar Straus. So I'd be dying, you know, I'd wait a week for the phone to ring, 10 days, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. Meanwhile, what little money we had was gone, and we'd borrow money. And my agent finally calls and says, Frostrow's passed. St. Martin's passed. 14 publishers passed. And she started to say, oh, maybe, you know, we should just put this aside. And I said, Cynthia, this is all I have. I can't go another 2 years and come up with another book. I'll be, you know, I'll be bankrupt. You just have to, I remember saying, I have to ride this wave all the way in, whatever happens. And then one fine day, an aunt who was, well, this wasn't a fine day, but an aunt who was very close to me on my mother's side, Lois Hagar, died suddenly. And she had always been a big fan and supporter. And about 2 days later, I got an email from my agent saying that the book had been accepted by Shea Earhart has her own imprint. And she's a really wonderful editor. So that's basically the history of him during those days. But then went on to get better reviews than any book I ever wrote, I have written since, and which makes me, I have this perverse side that makes me want to make copies of the reviews and mail them to the 14 editors. Because I just got a royal estate and I know how many. I didn't think it would. they're all different, and you love them all. You might love them in a different way. You might love different things about them. And really, that's really the true answer for me, is that I like different things about all the books, but probably Russian Requiem is my favorite book, which sold by far the fewest copies of any novel ever written. But that, a lot of times, has to do with the internal workings of the, you know, editor resigning, publicist having pregnancy leave, all those kinds of little things that it doesn't, it's not always a reflection of the quality of the book. But I have a soft spot in my heart for that. The only way I have of judging that is, you know, you get reviewed nationally, and I get letters from people. I get letters from some in California, from all over the place. Occasionally, I get phone calls, which it's not always the greatest thing. Sometimes, I mean, it's nice, but sometimes you get whack. People call you. I had a guy call me up. I hope he's not in the audience. He was from Indiana, and he read something I wrote about died on flight 93, the plane that crashed in Pennsylvania on September 11th. This, one of the people who led, the person who really organized and led that revolt, his parents asked me to write a book about him, which I had done. It hasn't come up, it hasn't been bought. But it was excerpted in Reed's Digest, and I got a call from some guy in Indiana who said that he was convinced, he was very energized and upset, and he was convinced that there was a conspiracy that involved Hallmark cards. And he had a Hallmark card from 1989 that had a picture of the Twin Towers on it. And he knew that, you know, the people who really owned that company actually had planned and executed. And he was all upset because the FBI wouldn't listen to him, and the police wouldn't listen to him. He was calling all these people. It was a little scary. The guy was obviously crazy and very angry. And I just said, look, I'm just a writer. I'm sorry that happened. I can't feel like, you know, I can't help you. I don't have any contacts in the FBI. But I had letters from different parts of the country.
I have two questions. One is, what parts of the book are true? And the other question is, in the very end where Uncle Peter was singing that song, how did that relate to the rest of the book?
Okay. To answer the first question, some parts are true and some parts aren't. And to answer the second question, I never think in terms of a theme. I don't even like the word. I don't draw outlines for my books or plan them. I just write the first sentence or the first scene and then go. And wherever it goes, and I figure if it goes a bad place, I'll fix it. But if I look back at the books, I can say, okay, from my subconscious, there was this idea, it was one of the ideas in the book. And one of the ideas in that book had to do with my own personal struggles with the definition of masculinity, manhood, and I never was a tough kid. After about the fourth grade, I think I won a couple of fights in the first three grades, and then that was the end of my career. And where I grew up, that was, you know, that, at least in my family, and I think in my neighborhood, that was an important thing for a boy, to be a good fighter, to be tough, and that was embarrassing. That was difficult for me, and it took me a lot of years to figure that out inside myself. You know, I had all these close uncles, and I was growing up, brought up on stories of, you know, this uncle beat the crap out of this guy, and this cousin beat the crap out of that guy. This, you know, it's all said, and it was like the lives of the saints, you know. Sticker, at least where I live, there's a bumper sticker that says, "My son, be up your honest school." And I was an honest I was shocked when I went to Italy the first time, and every time since, at the way the men are. The men push their little babies in strollers and make goo-goo faces. They hold each other's arms when they walk down the street. They weep in public. These are the macho Italians, you know. And it was shocking to me. They're no less masculine that I can tell, you know. But they're free to do that, so they don't feel bound, they don't feel inhibited about that. And I realized that I had grown up with some of that and not really paid attention. Like when my father died, I remember vividly, he died suddenly, I didn't have a chance to say goodbye to him. And my Uncle Bobby came up behind me at the wake and massaged my shoulders. And he said, if you want to cry, go ahead. You know, that's a nice thing for an uncle to say to a boy. To a young
man. I was 30.
And my grandfather in this book is trying to get that message across to Tonio, my grandfather, his grandfather. He's trying to get that message across to him. He's trying to say, okay, be tough, be strong, be a solid presence in the world. But don't be ashamed of the other parts of you, you know? If you're a good singer, sing. If you're smart in school, be smart in school. If you feel embarrassed or ashamed, you feel embarrassed or ashamed. You know, it's not the end of the world. And Uncle Peter is not able to do that in his life. Uncle Peter's a tough guy, you know? He has this very sensitive heart, and he clothes it behind this big personality. And his father was trying to tell him, that's okay, but there's something else in there that you can let out, and it's all right, you know? And so the great gift that Grandpa Don gives Tony at the end of the book is to make his uncle, the tough guy, sing. And he sings in a high voice. That's his voice. It's a beautiful voice, you know. He has to go up in the back of the grapevine where nobody can see his face to do it, but he does it. And I'm always going to leave this section. I think it's, let me read the last line. It's a great question. I hugged Uncle Peter when he finished and thanked him and thanked my grandmother, but it was years and years before I really understood what had been given to me on that night. And that's what's given to him. That message. You want to be a tough hockey player? That's fine. That's great. That's a good thing. You want to be able to endure pain? You want to be able to challenge your own fears? Wonderful. And then there's other good stuff, too.
Thank you.
I know you get a great education at St. John's Prep. Do you ever wish your high school?
Yeah, sometimes I do. Yes. Sometimes I feel like it makes me young. That question was asked by a man that was one of my closest friends when I was a kid. We played a lot of sports together. It's kind of a mixed feeling for me because the instant that I went to St. John's, and even more so when I went to Exeter, I felt like that was where I was supposed to be. I felt completely at home in both those places. At Exeter Academy, where there are, as you know, a lot of very, very wealthy people, I felt immediately at home. And I look back on that now, and it feels a little strange to me that that happened. But at the same time, I wonder sometimes if by going to those places that I ran away from some things I should have faced in Revere High. Like if I could have found my way to be myself in Revere after about the sixth grade, I think that would have been great for me, but I couldn't do that. I couldn't seem to do that. And when I went to those other schools, it made it easier for me to do that and sort of let me step aside. And now I can go back to Revere and I feel like myself. But in the seventh and eighth grade, and I don't think I was alone in this in those years, those were tough years for a lot of people. I didn't at all, and I felt miserable. And my father said to me, somebody came up to my mother and said, this I find unbelievable, she told me this about 5 years ago, some woman who she barely knew came up to her and said, you should get your son out of here. You should send him someplace. Why she said that, I don't know how she knew me, but she was right. And my mother believed her. My mother sent away for these catalogs for these schools that we had never heard of. And I got into them. And my father, and I got scholarships. And my father said to me, do you want to go? And I said, I'm dying to go. Let me go. I got into Exeter with a scholarship when I was in the 8th grade to go in the 9th. And he said, and I was a little puny, you may remember, Mike, you might remember too, I was a little 4'8", pipsqueak. There's a little vignette in this book where a girl in the 7th or 8th grade takes my shoe and holds her over her head. That really happened. I can say her name, but I won't. And I was dying to go. I wanted to go. He said, you're not mature enough to go away. Why don't you go to St. John's? That's a great school. Go there for 2 years. If you still want to go away, you reapply and you get an offer to go. And that's what happened. So it's a long answer to the question. Yes is the answer. Yes is the answer.
You mentioned in one of your books that you spent some time in Vermont. Could you tell me where?
Rutland.
Lebanon?
Rutland.
What were you doing in Rutland?
I, after grad school, I went and worked in the Soviet Union for 8 months. And it was a tremendous experience for me, and it really uprooted me. And it really turned my mind inside out in a funny way. I think part of that was I had a very nice Russian girlfriend. I think part of that was, I did have a very nice Russian girlfriend. I think part of that was that in those years, 1977, we thought of them as our enemies, and they were our enemies. But when I actually got there, and my job was to talk to people all day, basically, about America in Russian, and the people were so wonderful that it was confusing. It made me question, news reports, and it made me understand that there's a difference between. It sounds trite, but the difference between the average person and the government, and that was a big deal for me for some reason. And I had never really been out of the country except to go drive to Montreal with a friend of mine. And the first week in Russia, I was in 1,000 miles east of Moscow, in a little town where they still had electronic carts on the road. It was a shocking experience for me. And I came back from that, and I didn't really know what I wanted to do. And I went and lived in a cold little apartment in Rutland, Vermont, alone. There was no furniture. I made a little furniture. And I hitchhiked 17 miles to Killington, worked at the top of the mountain, making sandwiches, hitchhiked 17 miles back. 30 hours a week, and the other time I walked and thought and went to the library a lot, and I wrote a couple of poems, and I just didn't know. I just was trying to sort of figure out something in myself. And the people there were incredibly nice. Something about that town. I've been back since, and I've had the same thing. Something special about that town. You'd be walking down the street, somebody would go up and say, hey, you right? And they weren't trying to, molest you or anything. And I was never late for work one day, and I had a big beard. I looked like the kind of person who would never pick up big black beard, long black hair, shaggy old coat, hitchhiking up, Route 4. And I never did get a ride every single day. Ski time.
I'm wondering about Rosalie, Uncle Peter's daughter, who's such a contrast to Antonio. I'm wondering, how did she die, and why didn't you tell us in the book how she died, or when she died, or much about that?
There's a couple of hints in the book. In my imagination, she's beaten to death by Cesar Gascon. There's a point in the book where he holds up his fist to her like this, and doesn't hit her, and I think Anthony says something like, there's a precursor of what was to come, or foreshadowing of how she would die, or something like that. And there's several other hints about her inability to leave him, and she keeps going back to him, and she says, He said he'd never do it again. He promised me he'd never do it again. So I don't specify, but in my mind, she's been to that fight. A lot of people say, Rose, we should have our own book. Yes, ma'am, you have a question?
Actually, that my comment was about, I was going to make a comment that I enjoyed it after Rose. That was the first thing. And the second thing, I was wondering about Uncle Peter's wife and where she was from. I forget where, but I was wondering if her character paralleled with anybody you met in the Soviet Union.
Anybody in that what?
Whether the character of Uncle Peter's wife
right.
paralleled with anybody from the Soviet Union, where she was this blonde, white, blonde Italian.
No, she was a big Norwegian.
Okay.
Yeah, the same idea, but not really. She's a character who's really made up. You know, I mean, I think sometimes it's easier to make up a negative character. And I tried to give her one or two little redeeming qualities, but I have to say I enjoyed it. There's a scene where Andy has an art exhibit and meets her at the exhibit and comes to understand her and a little bit to understand himself. I think he says something like, I had never realized until that moment how desperately she wanted to leave the house, how desperately she wanted to leave me there. How desperately she wanted some bigger life, some grander life. And I had never realized how desperately I wanted to, I think he says. But I enjoyed this little bit of revenge on her. You know, I think he says to her, you're everything I would want my daughter to grow up to be. That was fun. Speech patterns are very, very different, and I get a lot of, I use the word yoga with my oldest daughter, and she spelled it out, Y-O-G-E-R, she assumed that and I was in Little Rock, Arkansas at 3 o'clock in the morning once, driving back from California, and a Volkswagen bug with two absolutely beautiful girls I did not know, and a guy whose car it was. We got together on a riding board, and I was very hungry. I had very hungry. We had slept out in the desert. He didn't want the girls to drive his car, so we went right and I drive. I was exhausted. I had a beard, long hair, and hadn't taken a bath in 3 or 4 days. And we pulled into a diner in Little Rock, and I have a cork. I don't like to eat things with my hands. Like French fries. Now onion rings I will, but for some reason French fries I'd always eat. So the waitress gave me hamburger and French fries and I looked at her, I said, I need a fork.
I grew up in Revere, and it was a wonderful walk down memory lane. wondering why you changed the street names. First question. And then I used to work at St. Pierre's on Broadway.
Oh, yeah.
And so I knew a whole cast of characters, and I just found myself wondering if the people you wrote about were the same people that came into the store, if you know what I mean.
A lot of people ask me that. Usually, characters, you know, like Uncle Peter, for example, it's not, it wasn't like that in my uncle's. Part of him was like my grandmother, part of him was like my father, part of him was like Uncle Bobby, part of him was like Uncle Joe, part of him was like Uncle Cammy, you know. And a big part of it was just made up stuff, you know. I didn't have any uncles who were professional boxers. So it just, and the same with the characters probably that you remember from St. Pierre's. I mean, there may be in my recesses of my memory some character like that that, that I don't even know that I'm describing, that's possible. There certainly were plenty of characters when he did to fill many books. And the street stuff, I just, it's stupid. I mean, but I want, my mother still lives on the street in the same house where I grew up, and I guess it doesn't really make sense, but I guess maybe I'll put her name is listed. It's not like she's in hiding, but I just thought it would give her a little privacy if I had called it Essex Street, which is what it is, you know. I don't know. Occasionally, I thought maybe one person someday would go by the house whom she didn't want to go by the house. And I also like the idea of the planetary streets, because the whole book, another, again, to use a word on my theme, is the small world and the big world, you know. And the biggest world is the universe, or the, I'm thinking of the planets, at least, that part of the universe. And so I was trying to play some little game with the very insular world that Tonio lives in, and then this, you know, he can walk the Pluto Street, he can walk the Jupiter Street, you know, but really, this world is a very small world. And for those of you, and I have known many people like this, Rosalie was very brave physically, but the thought of ever stepping outside that world where people didn't talk like her, didn't dress like her, didn't think like her was terrifying. So I just playing around with this.
I'll
come for 5 more minutes and now read for 5 minutes and I'm going
Did you know his parents would die and the manner in which they would die?
No. I didn't know anything when I started. I don't know if anybody's read Reading Beach Boulevard, but when I started Reading Beach Boulevard, I knew there was an old Italian carpenter sitting in his backyard on Mountain Ave or Parker Ave, waiting for the moon to come up. I knew that. I had that in my imagination as if it were absolutely real. And I wrote it, and then I just went from there. And then you say, you know, why, like, now we'll get back to his parents in a second, but you have to have some juice, some friction, some tension. They used to call it conflict, another word I don't think so. So if the old Italian carpenter was sitting in his backyard watching the moon come up, there's not much tension there, you know. But if he's sitting there with his wife, who he's been married to for 55 years, and she's in her last days, all of a sudden, everything's different. And if he then gets a phone call that his son is in jail, all of a sudden, everything, the moon is not the moon, the backyard's not the backyard, everything is infused with juice and friction, electricity. And that, I think, makes people, makes anyone want to go on. But as far as the, I didn't know Anthony's parents would die. But the same thing, I wrote the first 20, 30 pages of the book, I said, it's all very nice. It's too nice, you know, it's sweet. He has this nice family, he has a cousin, everything is going great. That's not true of the life that I know. The life that I know is bad things happen in different forms. You know, it might be health, might be the health of a parent or a sibling or a child or a spouse. It might be mental, it might be you lose your job, it might be world war, it might be the Nazis come over the border. Whatever it is, it's usually something. And so I wanted to be something for Anthony. And It had been a plane crash just like that when I was a teenager. My mother yelled upstairs to us that the plane had crashed, and my brother Stephen and I got on our bikes. I go crazy. It was very, very far. We could almost couldn't see to the end of Essex Street. And we rode to the airport, and we were actually able to ride. The security was just not functioning. We rode right out to the runway on the fog. It was very surreal, you know. We were riding out there on our 10 speeds, and there's flashing lights in the fog and sirens, and you know that people have died in awful way. They caught us before we got to the plane, and we stood at the gate and watched the ambulance. In those days, the ambulance, you could look in the back of the ambulances, and, you know, we didn't see anything gruesome except you would see parts of what I assume were bodies wrapped up, piled on top of each other. It was a very moving thing for me. I'll never forget it. And I remember one man, Leopold Chunin, lived for about 6 weeks, and he burned over, you know, 80% of his body, and they kept amputating a little more of his limbs and tried to keep him alive, and he eventually died. And made a huge impression on me, that kind of stuff. And why that one guy? You know, 98 people on the plane, one guy lives, why? You know, why didn't he just die like everybody else and get it over? Why did he have to suffer? So those are the kind of questions I would obsess about, and those kind of obsessions tend to find their way into what comes out when I sit down with that data. And, you know, once I decided that it was an opportunity to do some other things with the book, I think it, the way Tonio's family responded to that with him was a manifestation of their love. No, it's one thing to say his uncle loved him or his grandfather loved him, but then to demonstrate that and have his uncle give him, his grandfather give him skates and teach him how to play hockey, you know. And hockey was a big part of my life. My grandfather couldn't skate. My grandfather never did but did other things like that.
I, too, grew up in Revere and basically lived the book. You mentioned the Lincoln School burning down, and it was my elementary school. And how did that relate to, I think you mentioned in the book, knowing somebody that burnt the school down.
Yeah, that's true. Man.
It wasn't me.
Again, it's an example of reality and finding its way into the stuff. My cousin David and I would hang out at Corvus Stadium, used to be Corvus Stadium. And at the top of the grandstand, there was a wooden booth where the announcers would announce. And we were up there, you know, kids, summertime, you sneak into the park and hang out. I don't know what we were doing up there. And this kid, who we didn't know, who talked different, came walking up the grandstand and started to talk to us. And he started to light matches in a way that we both thought was a little bit odd, you know. First of all, it was wooden things, and he was just lighting man. He had some kind of a quiet fascination. And I might remember it wrong, but I'm pretty sure that a week later, or a month later, the Lincoln School burned down, and it was burned down by a boy. My cousin and I, for some reason that I forget, knew that that was the boy, or thought that that was the boy. I could have the details wrong, but that's what I remember.
It's a two-part question. First, how did you come up with the title in Revere in those days? And did you realize at that time that I'm from Malden, she's from Chelsea, you were writing in Malden in those days? You were writing about the Irish Catholics. You were writing about different ethnic groups.
That's the best thing I could hear, actually. I'm not sure I realized that at the time. My general philosophy or belief is that if you go deep enough into yourself, your essence as a human being, you will connect with everybody else who's different from you. I get very upset when people say, that's a man's book, that's a woman's book, that's, you know, how about a human's book? You know what I mean? I think there's a little too much of that going on these days, dividing people up by whatever you want to, you know, race, gender, politics, age, I mean, it never ends, you know? And I've had a lot of people say to me, I grew up in an Irish family, but this was just like that, all right? experiences those things, pretty much. So if you write about those things correctly, then you're going to get some universal note, I hope. One more now, a little bit.
I went to many of the book discussions, and a question that frequently came up, or a comment that frequently came up, was that people didn't feel the relationship between the chromosome and the cilia ran true.
That's funny you should say that, because I'm going to read from that section. That's a great question, and that really, and it hit, kind of seems in the book. And I'll just tell you something funny. My first and most important reader is my wife, Amanda. You have to be careful who you choose as a reader. You know, some people want to drag you down. Some people just want to go through it. Once it's the greatest book they ever read, because they want to be nice to you. And some people like certain kinds of books. You know, I mean, if I give my books to someone who reads romance novels or thrillers or, I don't know, political suspense books, it may not work for them because that's not the audience I'm aiming for. But Amanda, so when I give the book to Amanda, Amanda just looks at stuff practically. She doesn't care about pretty language. She just says, this makes sense that this person would do that, or it doesn't make sense. And she really loved the book. But one of the quibbles she had was that, you know, she didn't think Lydia would do something like she did with the boy at that age. And I said, okay, you know, I disagree, I'm happy to have that. Sometimes I change something that she doesn't like, and sometimes I don't have something. I had that in my mind. I was doing a reading in a town that shall not be named, and a woman who shall not be named, who was a little bit older than I am, came up to me, and I was signing books at the end of the reading, and she opened it to the page where Tonio and Lydia come into me, and she said, would you mind signing on that page? And I said, as long as you don't tell my wife. It's not like you don't go take the book to my wife and say, you know, this was me, and he signed on the page for all kinds of things. And she had this look on her face that was part embarrassment, part happiness, you know. And she said, all I'll say is that I was involved in a situation just like that. I was involved. It was on the side. So I think that, for me, the deciding factor is not whether most people will do that, or whether one person will do that. Because a novel is about individuals. Could one person do that? I guess. And I was trying to motivate, which make it believable, because there was like a meeting of two terrible philosophers, two terrible beings that mirrored each other. You know, she had lost her son, her husband, and he had lost her.